world currency.
The New World Order.
Those are the roots of trouble.
I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to be. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. All I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people.
And now, welcome to another episode of Down the Rabbit Hole. Here's your host from federaljack.com. It's Popeye.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another live edition. It is May 8th, 2014. Tonight's edition, I am going to the woodshed again. You're all going to go with me. If you're hanging out, listening, tuned in. Who goes to the woodshed tonight? The Department of Veterans Affairs goes to the woodshed tonight. And I have a few other things I'd like to get into, hopefully, in the second hour. But I'm going to spend as much time on this as I need to take them to the woodshed. Now, I would have to do a week's worth of broadcast to actually woodshed the entire VA over all of their issues. Probably 2 weeks. Tonight is a few specific issues. And I'll throw out a few other things, but there's a few specific issues I'm going to focus on. Wait time for veterans seeking health care. Now, whenever I do a show about this stuff, there's always inevitably somebody in the comments, whether it's on Truth Frequency, Facebook, Twitter, Federal Jack, YouTube, wherever, that'll make a comment to the effect of, well, blah, 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 I don't feel bad for veterans, they shouldn't sign up to be oppressors, blah, 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 blah. If you can actually put that aside, because that's what enlightenment would call for, forgiving your fellow man for mistakes. And by the way, not all veterans are baby killers. Okay, so you need to knock that crap off. And not everybody signs up to oppress people. There's a lot more to it. It's not just very black and white. It's a very gray area in a lot of aspects. Anyway, when I do these shows, I'm not doing these shows to try to ask you to pity and, oh, feel bad for veterans. I'm trying to show you that there's a huge problem. And if they're willing to do it to their own, they're willing to do it to the citizens. And it should also be a message to the active duty military and to the people that are police and government agents. Look how they treat their own. They don't even take care of you. When they're done with you, they throw you away. So there's a lot more to it than just, oh, please pay attention to veterans. That's a very superficial way to look at things. That's not using any semblance of logic. Besides, if the government's willing to do that to their own, what would they do to you, who they don't really care about at all? Think about that for a minute. Just think about that. You can judge a nation based off how it treats its military veterans. People it sent into harm's way, and in the case of the present day, they sign contracts. They own your ass when you're in the military. But in that contract, it also states that if you're hurt while you're active duty, they have to take care of you medically. That's part of the deal, okay? That's the way it works. It's not like people are getting free benefits and they're sitting on their butts doing nothing and they're partying. These are men with broken bodies, broken spirits, in some cases broken minds, and women too. Now, the reason I want to take the VA to the woodshed over their wait times is because recently it has come out in the national news about a VA hospital where about 40 veterans had died. Well, this isn't a big surprise to me. Actually, I had a lot of people ask me about this when it first happened. And as the story has been coming out, information has been coming out, people have been messaging me because they know how I feel about Veterans Affairs and being a veteran myself. So they would ask me, how come you haven't done a show about this yet? And I said, well, I will in due time, but it's not a big surprise to me. Like, it's a surprise to some of you, but it's not a surprise to me. This is a reality that I already knew existed for years. This is something that I talked about with Luke Radowski in a video he did probably, I don't know, a year and a half, 2 years ago. It's the one where I played the audio on air before, but it's, if you see it, Luke had a, I had him blur my face out because we had encountered the VA police a few times while we were filming, and you're not supposed to film around there. They got all pissed off, and I didn't want them screwing with my medical records, recognizing my face, because I do go down there occasionally. So I had him blur my face out back then in the video. But go listen to the video. I called out Eric Shinseki, the head of the VA. I exposed stuff like veterans being exposed to diseases, being because they were having procedures done with dirty equipment. Equipment wasn't being properly sterilized. People get hepatitis, other diseases from it. Lives totally changed and permanently altered by someone's negligence at the Department of Veterans Affairs. And there was other stuff. I told them how there was horror stories of crowding in hospitals, or where the hospitals were not adequately funded or set up, and that surgeries were performed in broom closets. Well, Popeye, you're lying. Go on your favorite search engine of choice and look up what I just said. Type in VA surgeries at Veterans Affairs hospitals performed in closets, and hit enter. And watch what comes up, if they haven't scrubbed the internet of it. Go look it up. You'll see. This isn't something that's new, but I wanted to get into this tonight, and I wanted to talk about it with you all, because since it's a national story right now, well, since the country is actually paying attention to it for a few minutes, let me grab their attention, and let me expose a little bit more than what CNN's been talking about, and I'm not even going to give CNN credit, because of course they latch onto a story like this to try to take focus off other stuff. At least they're talking about it, yeah. But they could have exposed other stuff. How come they never talk about DU? Furthermore, how come all these congressmen and women are calling for Shinseki to step down as Department of Veterans Affairs, the Secretary of Veterans Affairs over there? If they're calling for him to stand down over that and leave his post, but they're not calling for him to stand down because they've covered up the facts about depleted uranium? What about that? Go in my archives and look at my two interviews I've done with Doug Rocky. I'm going to have to try to get in touch with Doug again and see if he's okay, but I know he's been real sick lately. And I've interviewed him twice. They're in my archives. Dr. Doug Rocky on depleted uranium. Just go to federaljack.com and type in Doug Rocky, D-O-U-G space R-O-K-K-E, and hit enter. And the two interviews will come up. Shinseki was his boss when he was in the military, who tasked him with cleaning up the depleted uranium on the battlefield. They knew that it was killing people and causing cancer. And now, he's the head of the Department of Veterans Affairs. And everybody's all pissed off over this kerfluffle with these guys dying. And I'll play the audio so you can hear what I'm talking about. But, and don't get me wrong, that's bad. But what about the DU? What about the millions of people that have been exposed to that stuff? Not just our own men and women. And by the way, the servicemen and women that were exposed to DU in the first Gulf War, if you listen to the interviews, Doug will tell you, you'll hear him say during the interview that most of our casualties were friendly fire casualties in the first war, which is the first Gulf War, which is true. And those all of those friendly fire casualties, most of them are now dead, if not all of them, because of cancer, because they were hit with depleted uranium rounds. So if they survived the trauma from the round hitting them, they were still exposed to the hot particles. And many of them within 5-10 years had died of various forms of cancers. So they survived being shot in deployment, but they were dead anyway from cancer. Shinseki, the head of the VA, knows this. They don't talk about it. It's this generation's Agent Orange. My dad's a Vietnam vet, and he's watched plenty of his Marine buddies die. My dad was an Airedale, so luckily he was flying around in helicopters and planes. And he wasn't exposed to it. He wasn't dumping it. But like my friend Ken Hildebrand, you guys have heard him on here once a couple times so far. He's a host I used to work with over at another network. Good friend of mine. Marine veteran, Vietnam. He was a door gunner. He was exposed to the Agent Orange. He has heart problems because of it. My father's friends have died of cancer and heart issues because of it. Are they going to talk about it? Are they going to admit that there's a problem with the DU? Is it going to take 50 years like it did with Agent Orange? And by the way, there was other things other than Agent Orange. Yellow, green, blue. They were called Agent whatever based on the barrel that they sat in because they were painted different colors depending on what it was. But they were all defoliants, and they were all chemicals, and they all caused neurological disorders, cancer, all sorts of crap. No joke. You think they're going to talk about DU? Yeah, maybe 50, 60 years when Shinseki and the rest of these guys are long dead and they can't be prosecuted. Maybe they don't want to talk about the fact that we dumped this crap in everybody else's backyard. How about that? I'm telling you, you have to go listen to the interviews I did with Doug Rocky about depleted uranium. And about all the other crap that we did. And by the way, it ain't just in people's backyards. I know there's a lot of ignorant Americans who go, yeah, well, it's not my backyard. F them Muslims. Screw them. Oh, okay, genius. Well, there's also shooting ranges here inside the United States at bases. And guess what? A lot of them, during live fire exercises, they use depleted uranium rounds. So guess what, genius? We got depleted uranium right here. Inside the U.S. And like I said to Doug, you know, one of the places that this has been done up in the Florida Panhandle, the Air Force Base up there. And he said, when I asked him, I said, so when a hurricane comes in and starts kicking up that dust and that dirt and the winds and stuff and throwing all those particles around, he said, the DU particles are getting picked up and blown around too. So how many civilians around military bases where they use DU during live fire drills? How many civilians have gotten hot particles in their lungs because of a dust storm or a hurricane or something else close by, depending on the location in the country that the base is at? And there's a few of them. Look what we did to Puerto Rico. Vieques. It's a little island off of Puerto Rico. The residents over in Vieques, full of cancer. Look it up. One case, and I actually played this audio. You can go back and look at my archives. I covered this about 2.5 years ago. But I played audio. You can probably find the video on YouTube. Look up young girls with cancer on Vieques or Vieques Island, and you'll see. This one girl, I think she, at the time she was 12 or 13 years old, and she had had two operations for cancer. She had had like half of her stomach removed because she had stomach cancer. She was 12 years old, and she was an island girl. Literally lived on this small island, very simple life, nothing, exposed to, well, what you would think, nothing exposed to like carcinogens, like big plants and stuff like that. No. It was all from the Navy bombing the hell out of the island using it as target practice. And between bombing it and then shooting it up with depleted uranium, people on that island are loaded with cancer. So I got sidetracked on this because Shinseki, the head of the VA, knows about all of this. Remember, he was Doug Rocky's boss in the 90s during the first Gulf War. He tasked him. With cleaning up DU. Friendly fire incidents and non-friendly fire incidents that they had access to because they knew that this stuff was toxic. Depleted uranium is this generation's Agent Orange. And there's a lot of people, whenever I talk about depleted uranium, the trolls come out of the network. They come out of the woodwork. They literally attack me in the comments. Doug Rocky is full of it. He's a liar. He's not who he says he is. Depleted uranium, there's nothing wrong with it. It doesn't cause cancer. Really? Then why are the parents in Fallujah afraid to have children? Answer me that, genius. Why, when a child is born in Fallujah, they no longer ask if it's a male or female. They ask if it's normal. Go back in the archives and listen to when I had Dr. Dalia Wasfi on. Good friend of mine. Go listen to what she had to say. She'll agree with exactly what I just said. In fact, she'll elaborate more on it. Fallujah is forever polluted because we dumped our toxic crap there. And by the way, the soldiers, the airmen, the sailors, and the Marines that were all exposed to that stuff are getting cancer. Why are Marines coming back and dying of cancer in such high rates? Leukemia. See, the VA doesn't put out a statistic or a graph at the end of the year that says this many Marines died of leukemia this year and their ages. But if you go look, you will find, you do a little bit of research, you will find that a lot of these Marines and soldiers that were fighting on the ground in Fallujah developing leukemia and in other parts of Iraq. Fast acting too. And in a lot of instances it's already killed a lot of them. From what? They're young. Some of these guys were in the Marines when they were 18, 19. Now they're maybe mid-20s, late-20s, and suddenly they're dying of leukemia? Does that sound right to you? Well, you know, cancer, Popeye, it doesn't discriminate. Bullshit. I know it doesn't discriminate. You don't have to explain how cancer works, but does that not show you that there's something wrong? Pay attention. DU is this generation's Agent Orange. I'll say it again. Depleted uranium is this generation's Agent Orange. If you think otherwise, you're ignorant or you're a paid shill. One of the two. It is not okay to take our waste, a radioactive, highly radioactive waste, form it into bullets and tank rounds, and then dump it in someone else's backyard. By the way, even if you're not shot with it, and you're just the gunner. Say you're the gunner on a Bradley fighting vehicle, and you fire 300, 400, 500 rounds. You guys are done with your firefight. You go back to wherever. You got to clean the barrel out. The crews, they're constantly maintaining the equipment, or else it breaks down. I mean, it breaks down even with constant maintenance. So they're constantly maintaining this equipment. They have barrel brushes. In the case of tanks, they're huge. And they screw them together, like little kits. You know, you unscrew them, put them in a bag, throw it in a compartment somewhere, wherever it gets stowed away on your tank or your Bradley fighting vehicle or whatever other, you know, new vehicles they come up with. But that's the basics of it. So when that guy pulls out the, you know, say it's the gunner, he goes out and they get back to the base and they're cleaning up the Bradley, and the gunner goes out and he takes out the barrel brush and he screws it together and he proceeds to stick it down the barrel and, you know, douche the barrel out and clean it out. Scrub all the, try to get all the you know, powder residue, all that stuff out of there. Any sand that might have gotten in there, any other particulate matter, anything else. Scrub it out, clean it out, pull it all out. Right? Make sure everything's operating properly. Well, the problem is, when they fired that depleted uranium round, when the round first went off, it becomes hot as it goes down the barrel. As soon as it's fired and it goes down the barrel, it's already hot coming out the end of the barrel. So as it comes out, it's releasing depleted uranium particles, particulate. And it's getting all over the front of the barrel. It's getting on the inside of the barrel. It's now coated all around the outside of that turret and the outside of that armored vehicle or whatever you're shooting from, even if you don't realize it. You see a coating of anything on the outside of the weapon or the outside there, it's literally coated in DU. Literally. There's DU particulates all over that. So, now you're the gunner, you're scrubbing the barrel out, and you're scrubbing back and forth, and even if you have a mask on, that stuff is still, it could get in your eyes, it can get in your ears. You only need one hot particle. One. So maybe they don't breathe it in. Maybe they don't get lung cancer. Maybe somehow it gets into their bloodstream in another way. Maybe it goes in through their eye. Or it gets absorbed through the skin. And maybe they get a huge, fast-acting form of skin cancer. That's not normal. And these guys are out there without adequate protection. They're not even being told. I mean, in the first Gulf War, when they were given mop suits, the chemical suits. The problem is, once you break a mop suit out, it's only good first time you use it. You can't repeatedly put your mop gear on and off, on and off, on and off, on and off. You have to get a new set from a sealed bag. Once you break the seal and you put it on, it's not reusable. That's not what they told our troops in the first Gulf War. So they had Marines running around doing patrols. If they pissed their commander off, whoever, maybe their first sergeant, whoever the frig they pissed off. And they'd be running around doing patrols in their mop gear as punishment. And then when something really did happen, if a chemical alarm went off, they'd be told, oh, pull out your mop gear and put it on. Problem is, that stuff was not protecting them. So any of the chemicals they were exposed to passed right through the suits. And they were exposed to it. It would have been better if they weren't even wearing the suit, because at least they wouldn't have been sweating as much and putting that much strain on their body. But the government denies all this. They'll tell you, no. Veterans were not exposed to the levels of anything during the first Gulf War. Go look up another movie called Beyond Treason. Radio show host named Joyce Riley put that together a long time ago, working with Doug Rocky and Dave Von Kleist. Beyond Treason, you can find it on YouTube. I've been on Joyce's show a few times. She's over in GCN. Go look up the movie, Beyond Treason. Watch it. They blew up places like Camisea, which... Camisea was a chemical munitions warehouse, and the reason why they blew it up is because there's video footage, you can see it in Beyond Treason, when they were walking through. The munitions say, you know, made in the United States. You know, the chemical munitions that Saddam Hussein had, bad guy, oh, he's violating rules. Yeah, we sold him the munitions. That's why they blew them up. They didn't want anybody to see, you know, made in the USA on the side of the box. Can't have the truth get out. So they blew it up. Well, when they blew it up, I mean, talk about retardation, they just blew it up, that stuff's going to get dispersed into the atmosphere, which it did. And our troops were downwind of a lot of it. Wonder why we have such high cases of Gulf War syndrome. Should go look up how many troops have died since the first Gulf War. The last time I checked, it was upwards of, I know it was over 20,000, 20-something thousand. I have to go look. It's like 2 years ago since the last time I saw the number. And I'm sure since then more obviously have died, though. But last time I checked, upwards of like 20,000 veterans had died, probably even more, from the first Gulf War of illnesses and stuff that they received afterwards. And the VA, in many cases, denied there was any connection, because that's what they do. The VA is nothing more than a huge governmental-run insurance company. I found that out the hard way myself, being a disabled vet. It's a huge government-run insurance company, and they will find any reason they can to try to violate that contract that you signed with them. Because although the government definitely wants to send you to go fight and die for them, they certainly don't want to take care of you the way they're supposed to. They don't want to honor their end of the contract, which legally they are obligated to do. So, young men, if you're out there and you're thinking about joining the Marines or being a soldier and I'm going to go fight terror, think again. Go be a firefighter. That's more noble. Be an EMT. We get back, more woodshedding. Stay tuned. And Shinseki should be fired and put in jail. We are back, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, I'm serious. Eric Shinseki should be removed from his post as Secretary of the Department of Veterans Affairs, and he should be arrested. I'm sure we could come up with a litany of charges against him. Treason being one of them. How about hiding the DU evidence, not talking about it? The VA denying any connection to any cancers or anything else? The government denying any connection to cancers or any other sickness? I could go on for 2 hours about depleted uranium by itself. In the chat, one of the chatters had asked if DU was used to make concrete. And by the way, if you're wondering, what do I mean about the chat? Because I know a lot of people listen via either just the stream or some a huge portion actually listen via the call-in number we have. We have a call-in number that you can listen to Truth Frequency to the stream if you want. But if you want to chat with some of the other listeners, and once in a while I drop links to things I'm talking about there, go over to truthfrequencyradio.com. And you can click on the chat room link there. Just go to federaljack.com, my website, and click on the Listen Live page. And you can listen to the radio show there and chat and interact. And you can also, if you want to listen on your phone, and I've been throwing this out there because a lot of people, you know, the limited data on their phones and stuff, but they have unlimited minutes. So we have a Listen Live by phone, thanks to Mr. Chris Geo. Thanks, Chris, for offering this up to the listeners. It helps people actually tune in more, especially, like I said, since people can't afford to get pay bazillions of dollars in extra fees for going over their data usage plans, and not everybody has unlimited data. So the phone number, if you want to listen live by phone, is 1-832-225-5308. One more time, 1-832-225-5308. And you can just dial it up on your phone and you can just listen live by phone that way if you have unlimited minutes. So just a few different options. Anyway, in the chat room, as I was mentioning, one of the chatters said to me, Popeye, isn't it true, or is it true that they use that stuff in concrete as well here in the U.S.? That stuff being depleted uranium. Yes. It's called DU-crete. You can go look it up. They say it makes it stronger. Right, radioactive concrete, because it's stronger. So the positives outweigh the cons. I don't think so. There's also depleted uranium used in, if I remember correctly, it's the tail fins of certain jets, commercial airliners. And I don't remember. It was the weight, you know, a weight thing. But almost like a counterweight or whatever. But yeah, Doug, if you have to go listen to those interviews I did with Doug Rocky. There's two of them. Go to my archives, federaljack.com. Goals, they're from, one was from last year and one was from, I think it was 2012. It was either 2012 and 2013 or 2011 and 2012. But there was one in each year I did with him. But I did two interviews with them. And they are in-depth, informative interviews about this stuff. All about the DU, the poisoning from the chemicals and everything else. And he gets into, I asked him about the DU crete and the DU and the airplane tail fins and everything. And he gets into that. And I even said that that's insane. Why would they want to put depleted uranium in concrete? That's like mad scientist type thinking. For real. Of course, I'm not saying that we don't have mad scientists, you know. And I'm talking like, remember the B movies? If anybody's old enough to remember USA Up All Night with Rhonda Shear, okay, when we were kids, and they would play like the worst B movies on there, and you know, the crazy mad scientists. The only problem is those people actually exist now, and they're either in the government directly or working for the government, you know, as like subcontract personnel. Scary, scary stuff, literally. Anyway, I want to get into this story, what I was talking about, what got me to talk about Veterans Affairs tonight and get into this, and I want to play some audio for you guys. The first piece is about this, the story that I was talking about, this Veterans Hospital, and I'm going to play the CNN report because this is the only place I've actually seen anybody actually talking about it. So I'm going to play the CNN report, and then I have a small piece from Fox News where they actually got the whistleblower. Now, again, yes, they're both mainstream, lamestream sources, but sometimes the truth does come out on those networks. Unfortunately, you have to actually be able to go through and wade through all the garbage to find the factual information. But it's important for you to hear what this whistleblower has to say, and I don't have access to her as of right now. Hopefully, maybe in the future I can get in touch with her. But they did, and she has some important stuff to say. She's the doctor that saved the paperwork and these secret lists and stuff. And the other one is the story at least explaining what was going on. Okay, and by the way, wait times, I know guys, I have friends, older, like World War II and Korean War veterans that are gone now because they had wait times. I myself, I've gone in for appointments and, you know, I would say I need to see my surgeon and, or, you know, the doctor, my primary care, even just to go see one of these specialists, I need to see my primary care first. 6 to 8 month wait. Just for one primary care doctor visit. And I actually had to change myself. I had to go through three primary care doctors before I got, the third one was the charm, you know? Third time's the charm, I guess. The first two, the one never showed up for appointments. You'd go for your appointment at like 2 o'clock and I'd show up at like 1:45 and the doctor wouldn't even be there, would have left already for the day. No call, clinic doesn't call, didn't call and say, hey, just to let you know we have to reschedule. Nope. Just no show. Just they left and went home. And then there'd be 10 or 15 vets waiting there that now, because they didn't see that doctor, now they're going to get, it's going to take another 5 or 6 months. And they would do it. They would say, well, we'll reschedule you. And then they'd give me an appointment 5 or 6 months out. And I would say, I need to see the doctor. I have certain issues. Well, that's what, in my personal case, that's what made my conditions worse. And because of it, I've had to have 9 operations since 2008. I've had 10 altogether since I got out, but I've had to have 9 since 2008. It's 2014. That's only a 6-year period, and I had 9 operations. You figure out how many I had each year. Yes, there were a couple years where I had multiple operations in the same year. You know why I had to have so many surgeries? Not because I was hit by an IED. I've been asked that. Did you get hit by a friggin' IED? Cause that much damage? Nope. It was their negligence and their wait times caused a lot of it, because your body, your injuries aren't going to go, oh, well, obviously I have an 8-month waiting period. I'll stop hurting until he can see the doctor. It's not how it works. And it got worse and worse and worse to the point where it started to cause other problems. And then I had to have multiple operations to not only fix the original problem, but to fix all the other problems that came after it. And, you know, I got to tell you, honestly, in my life, it's had a very negative effect on certain aspects. I mean, there's certain things that, because of the operations, like I have to deal with scar tissue and stuff. And if you've never had a huge operation and you've had nerve damage and torn tendons and ligaments and all sorts of other stuff, and scar tissue inside of muscle tissue and other stuff, and you've had to have scar tissue removed and everything else, you don't understand what it's like. And even though all the king's horses and all the king's men finally started to put me back together again, it was a bit too late for certain things. And there are certain things I will now have to live with for the rest of my life, extreme pain included in certain aspects, because of their neglect. Now, I'm not sitting here crying to you, oh, poor Popeye. I'm using myself as an example so you guys can understand. I'm taking it to a more personal level so you can understand. And this isn't biased by my emotion or anything. As you can tell, I'm not screaming, yelling, I'm being very calm. I'm telling you the way it happened. And it's not my perception. It's not anecdotal evidence that, well, you know, it's just his perception of it. You could have said that a while ago if I had just started talking about this out of nowhere. But aha, we have even the mainstream admitting that the very same problems go on and veterans have died because of it. But it is not at this one VA hospital alone. It is a system-wide failure. For you to understand why the entire system is such a piece of garbage, ladies and gentlemen, you have to understand that the system was never set up to work to begin with. It was never created. The system that is created was never set to actually be able to handle the influx of the real amount of veterans that need the assistance and the health care from their exposures, their deployments, their injuries, whatever. It's like a false front. It's like those old Western movies where the front, in some aspects, the front of the buildings looked real, but behind them it was empty hollow sets with just 2x4s holding it up. If you know the old Mel Brooks movie, Blazing Saddles, they build a fake town, okay? That's what the VA is. It's that fake town. On the outside facade looks grandiose. We're taking care of our veterans. Department of Veterans Affairs, brought to you by Eric Shinseki. But they're not. If you walk through the doorway, you look on the back, you see the 2x4s holding up this fake facade, this fake town. It's not what you would think. So, that being said, I'm going to get into the audio of this story. First, the CNN clip, where they actually, lay out, they actually did a decent job. The reporter, by the way, Drew Griffin in this, that does the reporting, this guy actually does some decent reporting. I'm surprised that I know the way CNN works and all that, but he has done some decent reporting over the years to the point where he actually ended up getting on one of TSA's infamous no-fly lists, and now every time he flies, he gets ID'd and second screened and everything else because he had done multiple stories exposing TSA criminality and things. And again, I'm not saying he deserves a Pulitzer Prize or anything like that, but at least the guy doing it, I know that he has done some decent reporting. I'll say decent because it's CNN, but he has done some decent reporting in the past. Anyway, here's the story from CNN about 40 deaths resulting from VA hospital's secret waiting list. And again, this is not just one hospital, it's nationwide.
Tonight at 360 exclusive, the most disturbing example yet in our ongoing investigation of U.S. military veterans dying while they wait for medical care at VA hospitals. As a result of our previous reporting, Congress launched an investigation. Now we've uncovered just how far one VA hospital went to hide its outrageously long wait times. 40 veterans died while waiting for care at this hospital. And that would be shocking enough. Keeping them honest, though, there is more. A doctor who's left the hospital says that managers were actually keeping two waiting lists, a sham list that made the hospital look like a model of efficiency, and a secret list that showed the deadly reality. Your senior investigative correspondent, Drew Griffin.
It was a plan by top management at this veterans hospital in Phoenix, Arizona, to hide as many as 1,600 veterans, waiting many months just to get a doctor's appointment. CNN has learned at least 40 veterans left waiting for care. Many who are on that secret list are now dead. And what's worse, according to multiple sources, the management's plan included shredding the evidence to hide the fact there was a waiting list at all.
We've heard as many as 40 veterans here in Arizona, in the Phoenix area, could have died waiting for care.
That's correct. The number's actually higher.
Dr. Sam Foote just retired after spending 24 years with the VA health system here in Arizona. The veteran doctor says the hospital did have a list that showed the VA was providing timely appointments within 14 days. But that was a sham.
The only record that you have ever been there requesting care was on that secret list. And they wouldn't take you off that secret list until you had an appointment time that was less than 14 days. So it would give the appearance that they were improving greatly the waiting times, when in reality it had been 6, 9, in some cases 21 months.
In the case of a 71-year-old U.S. Navy veteran named Thomas Breen, the wait ended much sooner.
He started bleeding in his urine. So I was like, listen, we got to get you to the doctor.
Teddy Barnes Breen says his Brooklyn-raised father, Thomas, so proud of his military service, would go nowhere but the VA for treatment. And on September 28th, with blood in his urine and a history of cancer, Teddy and his wife rushed him to the Phoenix VA emergency room, where he was examined and sent home to wait.
All they wrote on his chart was, must have primary doctor in 1 week.
Urgent.
And they sent him home.
This is a copy of Mr. Barnes' VA medical chart stating...
I'm going to pause it there for a second. I have a friend, good friend of mine, Coast Guardsman and Merchant Marine, veteran of both. He's got a heart condition from when he was in the military. He was having problems with his pacemaker. And there was the company that the VA had purchased the pacemakers from. They were being sued because of bad leads and everything else. Long story short, they knew he was having problems with his pacemaker and his heart. And he said, you know, he called up to make sure that he could get an appointment. And they told him, oh, it's going to be about two and a half weeks, because his cardiologist called him and said, tell them you need an appointment ASAP. He had to call his doctor and have his doctor force them to give him an appointment the next day. Because it didn't matter. The appointment-making people, the clerks, whatever you want to call them, well, the computer system, there's nothing available. There's nothing we can do. That's how useless they are. So just so you know, again, it's not out of the ordinary for the VA. This is why I want people to understand this is sad, and this is totally unacceptable, but it's not out of the ordinary for the VA. That's why we need to do something about it. Completely 110% unacceptable on every level imaginable. So anyway, let's go back to the audio.
Clearly on the top, urgency, that he should be seen by a primary care physician or urologist within a week.
Did anybody call?
Nope. No.
You called?
Me and Pop called.
Numerous times.
And you never got an appointment?
I got a response. Would you like to hear the response? Well, you know, we have other patients that are critical as well. It's a 7-month waiting list, and you're going to have patients.
Lawyers. Sally kept calling day after day from late September through October through November. Then she no longer had a reason to call. Thomas Breen died on November 30th, 2013. The bleeding was from inoperable stage 4 bladder cancer.
They call me December 6th. He's dead already. With the burn.
They called you and said...
I said, what is this regarding? She goes, we have a primary for him. I said, really? You're a little too late, sweetheart.
Dr. Foote says Mr. Breen's a perfect example of a veteran who needed an urgent appointment with a primary care doctor and who was instead put on the secret waiting list, where he remained hidden.
And if you die waiting for your appointment, you didn't exist.
Correct. They can just remove you from that list, and there's no record that you ever came to the VA and presented for care.
Pretty convenient.
Pretty sad.
CNN has obtained emails showing top management, including Phoenix VA Director Sharon Hellman, knew about the actual wait times, knew about the off-the-books list and defended its use to her staff, which makes this statement to CNN from Hellman all the more strange. It is disheartening to hear allegations about veterans' care being compromised, the director writes, and we are open to any collaborative discussion that assists in our goal to continually improve patient care. Sam Foote says that response is stunning.
This was all planned, and it was planned by the very highest authorities here in Phoenix.
Correct. This was a plan that involved the PINTAD, which includes the director, the associate director, the assistant director, the chief of nursing, along with the medical chief of staff, in collaboration with the chief of HAS.
Basically, you have medical directors cooking the books.
Correct.
The Phoenix VA's off-the-books waiting list has now gotten attention of the House Veterans Affairs Committee in Washington, whose chairman, Congressman Jeff Miller, has been investigating delays in care at veterans' hospitals across the country. In a hearing earlier this month, he learned even the Undersecretary of Health for the VA wasn't being told the truth about the secret list.
Were you made aware of these unofficial lists in any part of your look back?
Mr. Chairman, I was not.
Congress has now ordered all records in Phoenix, secret or not, be preserved. That would include the record of a 71-year-old Navy veteran named Thomas Breen.
This is unbelievable, Drew. Incredible reporting. This waiting list for care, secret or not, must still exist, which means vets must still be waiting just to see a doctor. What's the VA doing about it, if anything?
Anderson, late this afternoon, the Phoenix VA sent us yet another statement, this one saying they acknowledge they've been having trouble, but they are improving wait times. We have no way of telling if that's true or not, and the VA in Phoenix will simply not answer any of our questions about what we're reporting, secret lists, and the allegations of trying to hide the fact that veterans are now, right now, sitting on that list.
The idea that there's a secret list, I mean, it's insane. No one is held accountable, and VA... the VA itself doesn't seem to really have an answer for any of this.
This is now the third story we've reported about veterans dying while they wait for care at VA hospitals on your show, Anderson. It's happened in Georgia, South Carolina, Texas, Florida. Now Phoenix, where the management tried to hide the true waiting list, and still we get no answers from the Veterans Administration. As far as we can tell, absolutely no one is being held accountable for this. And one more thing. But for this committee in Congress, one committee, all these politicians who campaign on taking care of veterans, including congressmen, senators, and in the White House, they don't seem to be paying much attention.
It's incredible. As you said, this is our third report on this issue. The idea that the VA isn't talking to us is, I mean, it's just incredible to me. We'll keep at it. Drew Griffin, great reporting, as I said. Thank you.
So there's a CNN report. Now, really quick, because we've got a few minutes left before the break comes up, here's Fox News talking to the actual doctor, the whistleblower herself.
Then the alleged secret waiting lists. Dr. Catherine Mitchell is my guest today. She's known now as the second whistleblower to come forward. Dr. Mitchell, thank you so much for your time today. What were your primary concerns about this secret waiting list? Because it's my understanding that you feared that certain people within the hospital where you were in Phoenix might try to do away with some of those documents.
Sunday night I was informed by an employee that I'd known a long time that he had knowledge of a list that if management got a hold of it on Sunday night or Monday, that they would be able to internally erase evidence that patients had been waiting for a long time to get appointments.
And what did you do after that?
Well, he called me and asked me what to do, so I thought, well, we'll go to the VA police desk. The VA police are actually, it's a federal police force, and there's one at every facility. We went to the police desk. After they spoke with their chief, they were unable to take custody of this potential evidence. They did recommend that we find a place to secure it within the facility. This employee and I went to the eligibility clinic where the list was, took it from the eligibility clinic, and then hid it in the clinic that I work in a place where I could keep it under lock and key until the next morning when the OIG would come.
Okay, so that was eventually handed over then to the Inspector General?
Oh, yes, that was handed over Monday morning.
Okay.
The employee and I met by the union offices, and then we... Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but Sharon Hellman, who was the person in charge at this particular hospital, she's now on administrative leave. She has claimed in interviews that she never knew that such secret waiting lists existed. Is she lying?
I don't know if she personally had knowledge, considering the fact that the second list was pretty common knowledge and standard operating procedure. I would have a hard time believing no one knew that it existed. Mm-hmm. Our electronic waiting list is kind of archaic in that when someone calls in to request a new patient appointment, that request is entered into a note in the computer. That note is then printed out and then hand-carried at the end of the day to the section where the electronic waiting list...
Okay. I want to make sure that I get to the other grave concern that you had, because you were in the emergency room. And you were so concerned about the care that veterans were getting there that you had recommended that it be shut down. Why?
Because we were inundated, actually, for several months. We were inundated with patients. We were only an eight-room emergency room. We were incredibly short-staffed in terms of physicians and nurses. We did not have any ancillary support services. Every time I wanted to get an X-ray on a patient or send them to CAT scan or get their blood work done, we had to pull one of our nursing staff out of the ER from direct patient care to do transport. At that point, there were so many near misses, situations where the potential to jeopardize someone's life were occurring, that there was no way that we could keep a handle on it.
Dr. Catherine Mitchell, she's now known as the second whistleblower, very brave of you to come forward as we continue to cover this story on a daily basis here on The Real Story to try and get the answers. Doctor, thank you for your time.
There you have it, right from the horse's mouth, ladies and gentlemen. Secret lists, standard operating procedure, and I can tell you from my own personal experience, the wait times are ridiculous. And by the way, the people that thought Obamacare was a great idea, you're going to experience what the veterans experience, long wait times and stuff. Oh, yeah. I know some people that they call their doctor, and what would have taken in the past maybe a week or two to have an appointment, now they're saying 3-4 months out. And they say, oh my God, it's what you go through. Well, that's what happens when you let the government run your healthcare. But for us veterans, beggars can't be choosers. I couldn't afford to pay out of pocket to fix the damage the VA and the military did to me. It would have cost me hundreds of thousands of dollars. They owe that to me, and they owe that to all those other vets out there.
This is Sparta!
The truth's not pretty, but it's the truth. Stay tuned. Hour number two coming up. When we come back, more woodshedding. Plus, I'm going to expose another problem that people don't really know about. Female veteran homelessness. It's something that nobody wants to talk about. Stay tuned. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to hour number two here on tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. I am your host, Popeye, from FederalJack.com. It is May 8th, 2014. Tonight, I've been taking the Department of Veterans Affairs to the woodshed. The stuff I've been discussing tonight, ladies and gentlemen, is not hyperbole. It's not conspiracy theory. It is, in fact, yes, a conspiracy, but it's conspiracy fact. And it's important to point this stuff out to you. It's important to tell you this stuff. It's important to point out the fact that we have been lied to. You have been lied to. If you're thinking about sending your little ones off to war, well, little Timmy, when he grows up, he wants to be a Marine. Maybe you ought to tell Timmy not to be a Marine, or a soldier, or a sailor, airman, or guardsman, anything. Tell them to find some other passion. Go be a cook. You want to serve? You want to serve your fellow man? Enlighten people. Tell the truth. Be an EMT. Be a firefighter. Do something that actually helps humanity. Don't go out and be part of the oppressive force. Because guess what? When they're done with you and you get hurt, they cast you aside, and then they fight you. They'll use their money and their power to fight you every step of the way. from giving you the very benefits that by law and by contract they owe you. It's not even about being fair, ladies and gentlemen, because life isn't fair, is it? No. They like to play games and they like to say they mean the powers that shouldn't be. Well, you have to own up to your contract. I've done plenty of shows about law, admiralty law, the law society, how we contract ourselves out. Constantly we do it. I've done plenty of shows on it. So I don't want to hear about it's not fair. Because no, it's not fair, but that's not really a sound, logical argument, is it? But what a sound, logical argument is that veterans sign a contract. Military usually holds it against them when they get tattoos or anything else. Believe me, I used to get tattooed every other day pretty much when I was in the military as a way of relieving stress. That, and I used to go walk down dark alleyways at night in the local city and pray that somebody would mug me and then work out some frustration that way too. I've talked about that. But I almost got brought up on charges a few times. You know what the charges were for? Never for getting in fights. You'd think that that's what I would have gotten in trouble for, but I never got caught either. I was good. But I got brought up by the captain of the base, the she. She wanted to bring me up on charges of desecrating government property for getting tattooed. She was going to bring me up on charges, whether it be a captain's mast, or it was too low to be a court martial, but she could have at least pushed for a captain's mast, which is what she wanted to do, or even something lower than that, like a negative page 7 or something. But she wanted to put an indelible mark on my military record at the time and punish me for getting tattooed. Punish me for getting tattooed. She said I desecrated government property. Now, the reason they can do that, which technically, even though it's insane, technically they can do that because technically they own you. No one owns me, Popeye. I'm free and sovereign. Okay. I understand that. But according to law, and the Constitution allows us to do this, there's a loophole in the Constitution that allows us, because we are sovereigns of our own destiny, therefore the Constitution technically can't tell you as a person. It can tell the government, because that's what it's supposed to do, but it can't tell you as a sovereign individual what to do. The founders knew that, and that people can say, well, it was put in there to screw the country, maybe. But also, if you think about it, they were also philosophers, and they probably realized that how are we supposed to say this is free if we force? So that could have been used as a justification by a more nefarious group to put that back door in there. Who knows? Anyway, the point is that back door exists. That and we can debate as to who and why it was, who put it in there and why, but who benefited from it. But the point is the back door exists. And if you think about it on a philosophical level, you are the one that are in charge. So if you allow yourself to contract yourself out because you don't educate yourself to what's going on, well, that's your fault. Well, Popeye, they throw so much stuff at me. It does not matter. It is your responsibility to weed through the crap. And if you're too lazy to do it, well then, that's what happens. That's what happens. Okay? So anyway, understanding contracts and stuff, you have to understand that this is, if you're going to look at this at a logical level, this isn't about what's fair and what's not fair. We sign contracts. They are violating their end of the contract. The problem is good luck taking them to court. See, that's why when people fight the VA on their own, veterans fight the VA on their own, they end up usually dying off most of the time, or at least about 50% of the, 40 to 50% of the time, they either die off or quit. And that's what the VA hopes for. Social Security is set up the same way. Anybody that's ever applied for Social Security disability or Social Security benefits when they get older will understand, especially the disability part, that you'd understand. I mean, they make you jump through hoops when you try to get your retirement. But even the disability itself that you pay into, remember, that's not a – the disability thing isn't a free benefit. You have to pay into that. There are people that do abuse the system, but that's not the point. The point is you pay into that. Well, the same thing with that. It would 75 down here in Florida. It's a known fact that the state or whoever the office there in the capital of the of disability, because it's more of a federal thing, but they wherever it goes, that head office, you know, up in the state capital, and then from wherever connections it's got to, you know, Washington and whatever office makes the final decision or whatnot, their SOP is to deny like 75% of claims that come in. Therefore, they only have to deal with 25%. You know, there's that 25% of the claims that come in they approve, and then the other 75%, out of that 75%, maybe 50% of those people will appeal. The others give up. And the ones that give up, some of them die or who knows what happens to them. And then the ones that appeal, about out of the 50% that appeal, maybe 45 or 50% of those fall off. Eventually, they don't have the patience to wait 3-4 years, because that's how long they'll drag it out in some cases. They don't have the patience, they don't have the money, or they get sick and they die. And that's what they wait for. The VA does the same thing, and so does Social Security. It's really absolutely disgusting. Anyway, I said when we were coming into hour two, or going into the break to come into hour two, I wanted to play a piece of audio. It's from Journeyman.tv. They do some interesting investigative reports. They're over on YouTube. But they exposed a big problem that not many people know about, and I want to dedicate the rest of the audio of this segment here to it. And the title of the video, you can go watch it on YouTube. I suggest you watch the whole thing again after you hear the audio component here so you can see the video too. But it's titled, How 55,000 Female Veterans Ended Up on the Streets. That's right, How 55,000 Female Veterans Ended Up on the Street. You know, I say never leave a fallen man behind, but I also will not leave a fallen woman behind. I don't leave any of my comrades behind. So to my sister veterans, let me expose your plight, ladies, to the listeners and to the world. Again, you can find the video. It's over on Journeyman. The website is journeyman.tv, and I'm sure they have the report up there. But they're also on YouTube. They have a YouTube channel. I believe it's, if I remember correctly, it's called Journeyman Pictures. So go watch the YouTube. Go watch the video and spread it around. Tell people about it. I mean, this stuff needs to be told. There are, just like there's male veterans out there that are homeless and have no place to go, there are female veterans that are affected by combat now and everything else. Remember, it's not like it used to be where it was just the guys. There are women out there as well that are affected by it. So anyway, here we go. How 55,000 female veterans ended up on the streets.
The backstage excitement is building at this most American of contests, a pageant. But tonight is no ordinary event.
Is that what you'll be wearing under your dress tonight?
No, but it's in my heart and spirit.
The contestants are all serving or former members of the US military, and they've each raised thousands of dollars for a special cause.
I'm a veteran, and I hate to see female veterans being on the street and not being able to be helped.
Great, it's been a good time. All right, I'm going to go get my photo taken.
Alrighty.
The very existence of homelessness amongst female veterans is a largely unreported and uncomfortable issue in America. It's estimated there are up to 55,000 homeless female veterans across the country. This event's organizer, Jaspin Booth, was once one of them.
And it was a huge slap in the face.
Yeah.
Because in return for the service I rendered to my country, I was offered poverty in return. However, if I was a male veteran, the possibilities were endless. There were all types of programs and, you know, training and housing that was available if you were a male veteran, and programs that treated you with dignity and respect.
Hi, come on in.
please.
A few years on, and Jaspin has managed to create this.
This is the living room of the Alexandria home.
She started a foundation called Final Salute, which now runs three transitional houses for homeless female veterans and their children. It's a start, but Jaspin is still frustrated by the lack of services for women.
Enough is not being done, and I personally don't think you can do enough for a person who has raised their right hand and said, hey, I will die for anyone in the world, not just Americans.
The past decade has seen a number of foreign conflicts with female soldiers in the front lines. As a result, more and more are suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD.
In Iraq, I was actually on suicidal watch. I had a recruiting dream of, I'm on tower guard duty, and we're getting mortars just thrown at us, left and right. And I offed myself, and that's it.
Tracy Arona deployed to Iraq during the troop surge of 2007. She left the army at the end of 2008 to return to normal life, but her life didn't return to normal.
I remember coming back from Iraq. I went to Walmart and pretty much freaked out because there was just so many people, so many noises going on, and I literally pretty much had to run out because I couldn't stand it. And didn't go shopping until like what, like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. It was like I couldn't, unless I was intoxicated, and it was just like, okay.
Like many others, Tracy turned to alcohol to numb her anxiety and insomnia, drinking nearly 2 bottles of tequila a day. And after separating from her husband, Tracy found herself homeless, bouncing between friends and relatives.
This soldier right here, he actually tried to commit suicide, and he was also our best friend, so they ended up kicking him out. So it's just kind of sad.
Currently, Tracy is boarding here with her uncle's ex-wife, but that too could prove temporary. Homelessness is an all-too-common consequence of PTSD.
Yeah, do you still have trouble with dreams and sleeping?
Yeah, like last night I didn't go to sleep till 2, and I sleep with the monkey. I don't know if you see him behind me. That's what I sleep with. And I take to think of him as like my dream catcher in a way.
The only thing that's gone right for Tracy was meeting another veteran called Joe Leal.
I started to notice that there was some alcohol issues. She was screaming for help. So I was able to get her connected with a service officer to help her with a disability claim, a counselor for drinking, and then I became like her sponsor, and I'm not even an alcoholic.
Yeah, put these in the bottom.
Yeah, we'll put those in the bottom.
Joe Leal has founded an organization called Vet Hunters that helps homeless veterans get off the streets. Today they're taking supplies to a homeless camp under an LA freeway.
Smells right here, so be careful.
Their mantra is to leave everyone better than they found them, and in return they get plenty of help in finding troubled veterans.
So, any new people here? I see that. I recognize
Joey. I don't think you've met Joey yet. Joey's gone right now though.
Okay. And yeah, the females? And the females over there? Same ones?
For the most part, the females that we're running into, they want out. They're like, I can't do this. Not to say because they're females, because they're survivors. But they're usually getting, for example, Sandra, the one we got off underneath the bridge. She goes, Joe, I can't be here. All these guys either try to rape me, they try to assault me.
Yeah, this is one of the worst streets right here.
Los Angeles Skid Row is another place where the Vet Hunters regularly look for former soldiers in need.
Hey, you doing?
How you doing, brother?
I'm feeling a lot of
work. Oh, you are playing louder? You got that itch?
I've been trying.
How you doing on socks today? You okay?
Oh, I need a little bit of socks.
A little bit of socks?
Yes.
Yeah, let me get you a set. Right. Hey, the only thing I'm asking right now is, do you know where the female veterans are at right around here?
Female veterans? No, they'd be like way back that way.
The challenge for the vet hunters is that homeless female veterans tend to hide their problems and avoid the streets and shelters.
They don't want to go to a shelter. People will try to bully them, try to have sex with them. They're dealing with their own issues. They don't want to be around civilians or crowds. They don't want that. They want to be around other females in a female veteran program. They need counseling. A majority of them need like a support element.
It turns out that networking on this Army Reserve base is one of the best ways to find those in need, but it's still difficult.
They're not always going to come out and open up to you. For example, we just had a female soldier that just walked up, and she asked us if we could fix her tire. Now, I know that's not related to homelessness, but one thing that took place right in front of you was how hard it was to ask for help with a tire. Imagine them opening up to try to tell you that they have a homeless situation. That's even harder.
Yeah, your tires were bad. The two front ones were bad.
When we go to replace Private Maria Avalez's tires, it turns out that she too is homeless, bouncing between houses and living out of her car.
After I got out of the military, I tried to stay with my mom for like maybe a week. She didn't want me there anymore, so I had to leave from there.
Maria's story is the same one I hear over and over here. An unsupportive family and the wrong skills for a civilian job, leaving her with nowhere to turn. Until Joe swings into action.
So then now we know people that, you know, can help you out with that. And then we'll start talking about addressing your homeless issue.
I haven't had anybody help me before like that, so it's kind of emotional. That's a big deal, yeah.
Well, yeah.
Thank you.
But that's why we do what we do. That's why we're out there, you know, raising this money, so that if you find yourself where you're not eating or whatever the case is calls up, I promise you we'll help.
I got food stamps.
Yeah, but you know what's crazy? As a soldier to be on food stamps, that's so crazy. You serve your country, you're on food stamps. And I don't mean that in a bad way. No, I know it does help. And you know what? I've been there. I'm just saying that I just wish that we didn't have to live like that. So with much love and respect.
Thank you.
Give me a hug, you know what I'm saying? Don't worry about it, man. We got your back. I mean, we're all veterans.
The number one reason why female veterans are homeless is because of untreated sexual trauma.
Something that helped you from where you were before.
Dr. Laurie Katz is a psychologist who's been working with female veterans for over 20 years.
I'm a Vietnam era Air Force veteran.
Woo!
Today at the Long Beach Veterans Affairs Hospital, Dr. Katz has brought together a group of women who have all graduated from her 10-week treatment program called Renew.
I felt condemned.
They all suffer from military sexual trauma, or MST, and many had gone for decades without talking about their assaults by fellow soldiers or seeking therapy.
Why did I do that? I was ashamed. Why was I so ashamed? I knew it wasn't my fault. I knew it wasn't my fault. I knew when he beat me. I knew when he shot me in the neck. I knew when he held the gun to my head. I knew when he broke my back.
Some of the unique factors about MST is that it happens in an environment where someone continues to work and reside. The whole environment becomes a fear-inducing environment. They don't know if it's going to happen again, or the friends of the perpetrator might gang up on them to get retaliation if they report it.
And after all of that, he got his friends. They beat the ever-loving out of me and buried me. They thought they'd killed me.
Military sexual trauma is extremely prevalent. Many women, that when they first come, are so shut down that they don't even make eye contact. They have difficulty feeling any feelings, so they're very numb.
I guess I always had to make sure I was working so I didn't have to think anything about what may have happened to me in the military. It was taken from me.
I'm able to move on. I'm getting my motivation back slowly but surely. And my son is going to be able to have a mother. And I'm a year. In 4 days, I'll be a year sober. And so,
wow, that's great.
And I never
So this is huge. You've released so much, and you are all doing so much better.
You showed me that people out there do care. I didn't think nobody cared. Mm-hmm. And that's what touched me the most, is that you showed me that I was somebody. Mm-hmm. That I was somebody. That somebody really cared.
The Ms. Veteran America event is all about showing that some people do care. And while the contestants proudly strut their stuff, the fight for equal recognition as veterans still has a long way to go in America.
They don't equate the service and sacrifice the same as they do to the men. You know, just say you had a homeless male veteran and you're like, oh, you're homeless. America's failed you. You're probably homeless because you went to war, you had PTSD. But when it's a woman, it's like, well, what did she do to get herself in that situation?
Curbing the epidemic of sexual abuse of female soldiers is going to be key to reducing America's flood of homeless female veterans. It's a problem last year's pageant winner, Denise Gordon, knows only too well, and one she's determined to tackle on behalf of thousands of women like her who've been sexually abused while serving their country.
It's an opportunity for us to break down barriers and have courageous conversations on a problem that needs to be fixed.
She has become the symbol. Although she's experienced military sexual trauma, she's not presenting herself as a victim. She's presenting herself as a beautiful woman that have had both good and bad experiences in the military, but also saying, you know, hey, there are some women struggling that America has forgotten about.
And the winner of Miss Veteran America 2013 is Alanya Gutron.
Every female veteran I spoke to for this story was still proud of and deeply committed to the US military. But they know that to break the cycle of abuse and abandonment, they've got a fight on their hands.
Ladies, you're not alone. You are our sisters. And there are many of us that have not forgotten you. The government may have forgotten you. And you may feel forgotten. But there are more people out there than you know that are willing to help you out. So if you are a female veteran and you're suffering from any of these issues, whether it be sexual trauma, in the military, or PTS, or anything, reach out. Don't be afraid. Don't hide. Not every guy wants to try to jump your bones and rape you. Yeah, guys are guys, and some guys are idiots. But not everyone is like that. You ladies are not alone. I know it's a scary place. But the more you talk about your issues and the more you expose it, the more we can try to change how the VA handles female veterans. You're not forgotten. And there's plenty of us out there that will not leave a fallen comrade behind. Reach out to us. We're willing to help. Stay tuned, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back. If you know any homeless vets, give them clothes, food, and some love. We'll be right back. We are back, ladies and gentlemen. Final segment of tonight's live edition, Down the Rabbit Hole. I dropped the two links to the shows I did with Doug Rocky into the chat room. So if you go over to the Listen Live page over on federaljack.com, they're in there. I'll drop them in again towards the end of the show, because I know how the chat scrolls sometimes. So, but if you go look in the chat, you'll see them. They're there. But I'm going to play a little bit. I'm going to play a little bit from the last time I had Doug on. It was June of last year, actually. June 4th, 2013. You can go back and look in the archives from 2013. And the show, the second show I did with Doug is 6/4/2013. So June 4th, 2013. You can download it if you want and listen to it later. Or go watch it on the, or go listen to it on Federal Jack, whatever. But it's the I'll put the link and you can, you know, listen however you want. But listen to both of the interviews. Anyway, I brought up the last one I did from last June, and I'm going to play a little bit of it for you guys so you can hear. When I was talking earlier about Shinseki and the DU and, you know, the anthrax vaccines and them knowing and all this stuff, well, I put it right about to the point, you know, part of it where Doug and I were talking about that. And since I brought it up, I want to let you guys hear a little bit of what Doug Rocky had to say. So you can see I'm not just, you know, pulling this out of thin air. And then hopefully this will spur you to go listen to the interviews. And when I put this up on, when I put this up on Federal Jack as an archive, and when I put this up on YouTube, I will include links to both of these interviews in it, because this needs to be talked about. As I said, DU is the Agent Orange of this generation of veterans. But here we go. This is Doug Rocky from June 4th, 2013, on my broadcast last year.
We look at all the continued health effects of all this stuff, what we call Gulf War illness. Gulf War illness is literally horrific. And what it is, complex toxic exposures of all this stuff. And again, all this stuff is identified, or supposed to be identified, when the individual service member completes the post-deployment physical assessment form with the physician's guidance. For example, what's known as Gulf War Syndrome, which is for Desert Storm and Operation Iraqi Freedom, Enduring Freedom, the Balkans, Somalia, is, quote, fatigue, skin rash, headache, muscle and joint pain, memory loss, shortness of breath, sleep disturbances, diarrhea, and other GI symptoms, problem, gnawing skin, integumentary tissue, chest pain. This is why we have all these young kids dropping different cardiac problems in their 20s, all the incredible respiratory problems, all of the cancers and everything else. I mean, when we look at it, the Department of Veterans Affairs has issued very specific guidance to their physicians, acknowledging the health effects. At the same time, they disavow publicly and disavow to the soldier of any problems. I mean, it's just turned into an incredible, incredible problem. Substance abuse is rampant. Suicides are rampant. PTSD is rampant. It's devastating. You know, homelessness is rampant. Homelessness is rampant. Traumatic brain injury. Traumatic brain injury is another significant problem, but you have to understand traumatic brain injury happens not only from concussion, from explosions, or being knocked down or bounced around, but it also happens from incredible toxic exposures. Because all these complex toxic exposures have a horrible side effects on the brain. They affect the neurophysiology of the brain. And the Department of Veterans Affairs totally acknowledges, even for minor TBI, dizziness, nausea, insomnia, behavioral concentration problems, irritability, depression, anxiety, vision problems, taste problems, fatigue, and mood changes. As it continues to increase, we're seeing all of the problems that we go around, all the incredible levels of headaches, pain that won't go away, convulsions and seizures, inability to awaken, dilation to eyes and pupils, slurred speech, weakness, numbness in the arms or legs, loss of coordination, increased confusion, restlessness of confusion.
Once you're exposed, if someone is...
exposed, you're screwed.
So if someone has noticed any of these symptoms, are there ways to mitigate the effects that or the side effects of the exposure, or will it keep getting worse?
It'll continue to get worse, but there are ways that things that can be done to mitigation, but that requires extensive medical care, surgery, and everything else.
And that would require the VA admitting that there was actually a problem to get that extensive health care that they would need.
Correct. The VA has to admit, and they still continue to deny, as the Department of Defense continues to deny. But we have to understand, what this is about is the fact that not only do we have millions of U.S. military servicemen that served our nation in the Army, Air Force, Navy, Coast Guard, Marines, and Public Health Service, they were extensively exposed. We have lots of police and fire and civilian communities that were exposed, as they did responses with 911, all those same exposures in World Trade Center and the Pentagon, as the explosive blew that place, both those places up, and the depleted uranium got exposed from the supposed aircraft impacts. So those guys are seeing all the health effects. But more important than all the civilians and all the nations that we've attacked, invaded, occupied, destroyed, blown up, the non-combatants are all seriously affected. So it's not a day that goes by where I don't have calls or requests, not only from civilian, from military personnel and family members and spouses that are sick, but I have civilians from all over the world and all over the United States that are sick as a consequence of their exposures from the releases on them. So, I mean, you're looking at an incredible extensive medical and significant medical problem for which there is no money and no funding and no desire to acknowledge or admit the problems exist.
The implications of what they're doing, not only with the DU, but if you look at DU vaccines and the burn pits, all put together, just the exposure that, that the people in the military plus any civilian personnel that working in the area that were, you know, right off the bat, that's one of the biggest health scandals, you know, like public health scandals, I think, in the history of this country. I mean, that would literally, I think that would really bring at least the VA medical system, if not more parts of the government, and I believe you even said this the last time I interviewed you, it would bring them to their knees if they actually admitted there was a problem.
Well, you know, trying to admit that there's a problem, but it's not only that. You've got total misuse of funds and everything else, where they're buying stuff and doing conferences and taking people all over the place. I mean, right now they've got asking questions about why the VA went to Europe. I mean, this is up in the, you know, investigations in Congress. I mean, total misuse of funding. I mean, we had a recent problem at the Danville VA Medical Center. We couldn't get medical care. They said they didn't have medical staff or they didn't have enough time, and that they were buying thousands and tens of thousands of dollars of new desks and file cabinets for which they had no reason. You don't need to have all new desks and file cabinets. You need to give medical care. Give yourself a table to work on, and that's it. When we look at all the health effects and everything that's identified, just alone, partially identified, in the post-deployment physical assessment form, where they acknowledge these are the health effects for which you need to get medical care. These include chronic cough, that's all the respiratory, runny nose, fever, weakness, that's in the muscles and everything else, joints, headaches, swollen and stiff and painful joints, back pain, muscle aches, numbness or tinglings in the hands or the feet, skin disease or rashes, redness of the eyes and tearing, dimming of vision like the lights are going out, chest pain or pressure, dizziness and fainting, light headaches, difficulty breathing, feeling tired after sleeping, difficulty remembering, diarrhea, indigestion, vomiting, ringing in the ears. These are the things that are acknowledged, that they're asking if everybody has this stuff. And yet they don't want to acknowledge or take care of the stuff. Then you get all the PTSD problems. What did we do? What did we see? What were we involved in? We're in the moral and ethical dilemma. We have found out that we've been lied to since Vietnam. We know the Gulf of Tonkin incident did not occur. That is a historical fact today. And yet Johnson and McNamara used it to get all of us into Vietnam. And we killed and destroyed for all this stuff without justification. We did the same thing in Desert Storm. And we did the same thing in Operation Iraqi Freedom and Enduring Freedom. Iraq or Afghanistan never posed a threat to us. They've never posed any threat to suspend our precious freedoms, no ability to suspend our government or anything else. No ability to really attack us. And yet we've destroyed them. When we look at the post-deployment physical assessment form, for which the Department of Defense totally acknowledges creates adverse health effects, the things they ask the individuals we're exposed to, deep insect repellent, pesticide-treated uniforms, this is the premium urethrin, which is a dangerous pesticide, environmental pesticide, flea and tick collars. We have kids wearing flea and tick collars. Kids can't wear them. Pesticide strips, smoke from oil fire, smoke from burning trash and feces. We got the directives requiring medical care for all exposures from burn pits and hazmat. Vehicle or truck exhaust fumes, tent heater smoke, JP-8 and other fuels. You have all the carbon monoxide poisoning, you have all the byproducts and incredible medical problems. Fog oils, all the solvents, all the paints, all ionizing radiation. Radioactive exposures are not just from depleted uranium. They're all the complex materials and equipment that's in our equipment, but more important, ionizing radiation we found is incredible stuff in the Iraqi, the Soviet, and the Afghan equipment that's released when we destroyed it. That's what's happened in Syria. Incredible releases of radioactivity as we destroyed Syria. And the same thing is what we're doing as we're destroying the stuff in Libya. All the radar and microwaves, all the lasers, all the loud noises, excessive vibration, industrial pollution, incredible amounts. As we destroy infrastructure for industry, agriculture, medicine, and education, incredible pollutants are released. All the sand dust, all the depleted uranium, all the other exposures. Incredible problems. They require that they go to the physician for everything. They don't have enough doctors or physicians. What we have found out, the doctors don't, the physicians in the VA and DOD not only don't have the information, they don't seek out the information, and when the individual soldier provides it to them, they deny that it exists. So you have total frustration. The individual served their nation, they're sick, they were extraordinarily healthy, now they're extraordinarily sick. When they ask for medical care, they're told it's all in their brain. And yet they have the copy of the directive confirming it, if they can get it. The physicians and nurses all know, but they refuse to admit or acknowledge it. They refuse to take the time to go and do it. Continuing education is totally broken within Department of Affairs and Department of Defense. They talk about trying to take Army medics and everything back in the civilian world, make them an EMT or paramedic. But yet they don't even know why they did the treatment or the care, because they didn't have adequate education before they were taken in the military medical program. And they don't know the anatomy, physiology, and body mechanics, so they can't translate it. We put the programs together 30 years ago when I was involved teaching the combat medical programs, the 91A, 91B, Super B program, combat lifesaver program. Our team put that together during Desert Storm, the shortened version, which is used all over the nation. I actually served as director for the Midwest. It's not done. So you don't have the capability to provide medical care. And the desire, the intent for the physician to spend the extra time and go look for it is not happening within the Department of Veteran Affairs, even when I called for help yesterday. Well, we're done for the day. It's 5-4. They start at 8 in the morning, and they quit it before 4 o'clock. That includes lunch hour. No wonder people can't get medical care. They don't want to work. They don't want to look. They don't want to understand. They don't want to investigate. Continuing medical education is broken. Acknowledgement. How do you tell the American public we have millions of U.S. military casualties as a result of our failures to act or our deliberate actions creating air, water, soil, and food contamination? How do we tell the American public that we created all these casualties for which we denied medical care? But then more important, we've got all of the family members, all of the spouses with cross-contamination brought back. That's within the U.S. family alone, the military family. Then you've got all civilians all over the nation for where this stuff has been blown up, tested, developed, or built, or whatever, or released, that are exposed. On the 18th of April of 75, hardly a man is left alive. We all know that from Paul Revere. Concord, Massachusetts is one of the most contaminated and adverse healthy problems as a result of depleted uranium munitions in the world, because of the Sarmet plant up there. The community where our nation was born is thoroughly contaminated with depleted uranium, resulting in serious cancers and all kinds of health problems. It's a Superfund site, day in and day out, week after week, month after month, year after year. The individual, the male or the female, went to serve our nation, went over healthy, came back sick, delayed or denied care. They're told to buy into the system. They're told to do everything they did was right, and yet they know what they did was wrong. And so they can't deal with ethical and moral dilemmas. And the mental health and the VA and DOD don't want to deal with any of the ethical and moral dilemmas. They just want to try and give you more drugs and treat you as if you something wrong with you.
That's all they do. I've seen it firsthand with my own two eyes. That's all they do. I've seen, I have really good friends. I'm a vet myself, and I have really, really close friends who some of them do suffer from PTSD, and rightfully so. I mean, that's a natural human reaction to seeing some very horrific things or partaking in horrific things. And then you understand, like you said, you've been lied to. They have these realizations later on, and that's a lot to take on. And see, if the government admits that there were these things that took place that were not right and they were wrong, and that's the reason why these kids are having the problems that they're having and they're committing suicide, well, that opens Pandora's box, because then that leads down the path to, well, what did you do that was wrong? Were there war crimes? Oh, and then you find out about the health effects and everything else, and they can't have any of that. All of that has to be put in a nice little box and closed up, because if there's any of that gets out, that's it. They're done. I mean, and that, it like you said, they've put this crap all over the world. So it's not just it would be one thing if it was just the military, but now you have civilian exposure here in the U.S.
All right, I'm going to pause it right there, ladies and gentlemen, because we're coming up to the break. I'll leave it there. You guys can go listen to the rest of the broadcast. It's from 6-4-2013, last year, and I figured I would, you know, let it play until the break came up, because I knew I had a different break schedule back then. So go back and listen to the whole broadcast so you can listen to everything. Okay. 6-4-2013. Down the Rabbit Hole with Popeye, June 4th, 2013, Doug Rocky on DU, Gulf War Syndrome, and Veterans Affairs. Excellent broadcast. And the other one I did with him is Dr. Doug Rocky on depleted uranium. If you go to federaljack.com, go up to the search bar right underneath the Truth Frequency Radio banner, right up at the top there. When you load up Federal Jack, you'll see right at the very top, federaljack.com, and a Truth Frequency Radio banner. Right underneath that, it says Home About Download section, by the way. That's where you can go to the download section. Video Store, Radio Show Chats, DTRH Radio Archives. That's another way to go to the archive page. And next to that is this little block that says Search This Website and then Go next to it. If you type in that little box, D-O-U-G space R-O-K-K-E. Again, D-O-U-G space R-O-K-K-E. Doug Rocky. It'll bring up those two interviews first. And then I have a couple, I think I posted a couple videos of interviews he did with like Jones and a couple other people from years ago. And I might have even put up, I think that might even bring up a link to Beyond Treason. But just type in Doug space Rocky, D-O-U-G space R-O-K-K-E in the search bar up where it says search this website on federaljack.com up in the upper right-hand corner. And when you do that, it'll bring up a list of stuff, including the interviews I've done with Doug. And I urge you to download them. Okay, obviously I know many of you can't sit in front of your computer all day long. Everybody has busy lives, I get it. But everybody has phones now, and a lot of people listen via their phone or their MP3 player or whatever. That's why I made it so accessible, by the way, for you to go to Federal Jack and download all those archives, because take them for free. That's the whole point. I want you to take them. That way you can go and listen and learn. You can take what you hear. You can go research it. You know, I know a lot of people that message me, they it's really interesting. That's one of the reasons I use Facebook, by the way, because people message me on there when they, listeners. And I have, you know, there's activists and stuff that I connect with through there. But there's a lot of listeners that reach out to me. That's why I was pissed when Facebook put my other account in forever Facebook jail and they sent it off to Gitmo. Because I used it to interact with people. And still to this day, the new one I built, I get new listeners telling me that, you know, I listened to shows from 2-3 years ago. You know, I just heard your show you did. A lot of times they won't say 2-3 years ago. They'll say, you know, I heard your show on this topic. And believe it or not, even though I've done well over 300 radio broadcasts, I remember the shows I've done. Especially if someone tells me a little bit about the show too. I'm like, oh, I remember that broadcast. Sometimes they'll tell me the date or whatever. But it's interesting because a lot of people do go in there and download the older broadcasts. Well, that's the whole point of me putting it up. I mean, I want you guys to take it. I urge you to take everything that's in the entire download section. That's the point of the site being up and having all that information. It's not there to look pretty. It's not there so I can go, look, I put all this stuff here. Look how cool I am. No, it's there so you people can come in, copy it, download whatever you want, and pass it around, show other people, listen to it. You know, I urge people that do YouTube videos. If you guys want to help me out, if I go off on a particular subject or a rant, and even if it's just a, you know, 10 or 15 minute one, you have my permission to cut that little audio section out and make a YouTube video of it, as long as you obviously, you know, give credit to where credit is due, put a little link to my radio show or the YouTube channel for the archive in the description box, and send me a link, and I'll post it on Federal Jack, the video. You know, I'll help boost it and give it hits, and I'll tweet it out all over the place and put it on Facebook. I'll even rip it and upload it to my channels and give you total credit, you know, and I'll give you a shout out. If people want to do that, you want to take little things that I've ranted about, subjects maybe you felt it was a really passionate topic and others should hear it, you know, cut it out and make a little YouTube video of it. Let me know. I would do it myself, but I just don't have time. I'm too busy rendering the full archives and everything for else. That's why it would be cool if I, you know, when I go off on different subjects and stuff to be able to do that, but I can't. So I go against the grain and I just put out the full high quality broadcast. It's, you know, whatever. People should listen to the whole thing anyway, but if you want to do that, that's fine. You have my permission. The whole point is downloading this information and spreading it out. And again, I'm not the end-all, be-all arbiter of truth. I'm not Superman, ladies and gentlemen. I'm just like you. Except I happen to be awake, maybe on a different level than you are. But all I'm doing is bringing humanity back to where it should be. I'm not even, it's not like I'm pushing us, Papa, you're raising us above. No, I'm not. All any of us are doing that do this are, is trying to bring humanity back to the level it should be at for 2014. Because it's been retarded, it's been slowed down. And the only way that we're going to become sped up, unretarded, and the only way we're going to unretard ourselves, de-retard ourselves, however you want to pronounce it, English majors, is to learn, is to grow, is to evolve as humans. That's why I do this. So if you guys want to go rip all the archives, they're there. Okay, listen to the older broadcast. That way you can put them, you know, on your iPod, whatever. Again, people listen on their phones. So if you have, go home. You don't have to do it when you're out. Go home or wherever you have Wi-Fi access. Go to federaljack.com/Popeye. It's really simple. federaljack.com/Popeye. You go there, and it brings up the directory, the old school, you know, 1990-style internet directory listing. And every link works. So your phone, when you click on it, or your mobile device, you know, it'll either ask if you want to download it or play it, or it might just automatically do it depending on what you've already set it to do. But download it. You can download all of the shows from there, and it works on phones, it works on iPads, everything. If you have internet access, that works. And I did it that simple for that very reason. Because it's done that way. It's easy. Very simple. Okay? Go download all of the shows. All of them. Scroll through, look at the titles, see what you want, click on it, download it, educate yourself. And I implore you to please take the two shows about Doug Rocky, that Doug and I did about the DU and the Veterans Affairs and stuff. The last few minutes here, I want to urge you all, if you know, and everybody that lives in a city or in an area where there's homeless vets that you know visibly see, you know what I'm talking about. Sometimes they'll sleep under like overpasses and stuff. Help them out. If you have clothes, help the homeless in general. You see somebody on the streets, most of them are veterans, at least 50% of them are veterans anyway. But if you know a veteran that's homeless, help them out. If you know a female veteran that's homeless, you know, try to help her out. Maybe you can contact those guys out in California there. And again, go to Journeyman Pictures over on YouTube and watch the video again. It's about 55,000, how 55,000 veterans, female veterans became homeless. Watch it, and I'm sure there's links to the thing in the comment section. Find the guy, see if you can start a chapter in your area, okay? Make a change. And then maybe you branch out and you just do it for all homeless people. But whatever, you got clothes in your house. I've said this 1,000 times. If people want to end homelessness and help end suffering, the first step to doing so is taking that humanitarian step and giving them clothes and helping them out. Talk to them. Find out what their story is. I used to talk to homeless people all the time when I worked in South Beach, when I worked at the tattoo shop. My friends that were like, well, why do you sit and chat with them? Because they're humans. They're not monsters. And not all my friends were like that. A lot of my friends were cool and they chatted with them. But these people were humans too. They all had a story. They all had a reason. So let's not just cast them to the side because they happen to be homeless. Don't be afraid of them. They're not all homeless because they're crazy. And oh my God, they have PTSD. They're going to kill everybody. Don't judge a man till you walk a mile in his moccasins, ladies and gentlemen. We have to do the right thing. If we're going to save this country and this world, not even this country, if we're going to save this world, if we're going to save humanity in this battle for humanity's future, part of it is loving each other and bringing that love for our fellow man back, regardless of if you know them or not. Gather some clothes if you don't need them, spring cleaning style. Maybe you lost a couple pounds. Get some stuff together. Don't give it to Goodwill. Go around, get clothes from your neighbors. Don't bring it to Goodwill. Drive around in your trunk with a bag and give it to the people on the street. That is how we'll start taking our humanity back. And with that, we're out of time. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope I've helped you see what veterans go through at a better level. I'll catch you all again live tomorrow night. Woodshedding over. The solutions to our problems are an inside job. I love you all. I'm out of here. Broken spirits. In some cases, broken minds. And women, too. Now, the reason I want to take the VA to the woodshed over their wait times is because recently it has come out in the national news about a VA hospital where about 40 veterans had died. Well, this isn't a big surprise to me. Actually, I had a lot of people ask me about this when it first happened. And as the story has been coming out, information has been coming out, people have been messaging me because they know how I feel about Veterans Affairs and being a veteran myself. So they would ask me, how come you haven't done a show about this yet? And I said, well, I will in due time, but it's not a big surprise to me. Like, it's a surprise to some of you, but it's not a surprise to me. This is a reality that I already knew existed for years. This is something that I talked about with Luke Radowski in a video he did probably, I don't know, a year and a half, 2 years ago. It's the one where I played the audio on air before, but it's, if you see it, Luke had a, I had him blur my face out because we had encountered the VA police a few times while we were filming, and you're not supposed to film around there. They got all pissed off, and I didn't want them screwing with my medical records, recognizing my face, because I do go down there occasionally. So I had him blur my face out back then in the video. But go listen to the video. I called out Eric Shinseki, the head of the VA. I exposed stuff like veterans being exposed to diseases because they were having procedures done with dirty equipment. Equipment wasn't being properly sterilized. People get hepatitis, other diseases from it. Lives totally changed and permanently altered by someone's negligence at the Department of Veterans Affairs. And there was other stuff. I told them how there was horror stories of crowding in hospitals, or where the hospitals were not adequately funded or set up, and that surgeries were performed in broom closets. Well, Popeye, you're lying. Go on your favorite search engine of choice and look up what I just said. Type in VA surgeries at Veterans Affairs hospitals performed in closets, and hit enter. And watch what comes up, if they haven't scrubbed the internet of it. Go look it up. You'll see. This isn't something that's new, but I wanted to get into this tonight, and I wanted to talk about it with you all, because since it's a national story right now, well, since the country is actually paying attention to it for a few minutes, let me grab their attention, and let me expose a little bit more than what CNN's been talking about, and I'm not even going to give CNN credit because, of course, they latch onto a story like this to try to take focus off other stuff. At least they're talking about it, yeah. But they could have exposed other stuff. How come they never talk about DU? Furthermore, how come all these congressmen and women are calling for Shinseki to step down as Department of Veterans Affairs, the Secretary of Veterans Affairs over there? If they're calling for him to stand down over that and leave his post, but they're not talk about, you think they're going to talk about DU? Maybe 50, 60 years when Shinseki and the rest of these guys are long dead and they can't be prosecuted. Maybe they don't want to talk about the fact that we dumped this crap in everybody else's backyard. How about that? I'm telling you, you have to go listen to the interviews I did with Doug Rocky about depleted uranium and about all the other crap that we did. And by the way, it ain't just in people's backyards. I know there's a lot of ignorant Americans who go, yeah, well, it's not my backyard. F them Muslims. Screw them. Oh, okay, genius. Well, there's also shooting ranges here inside the United States at bases. And guess what? A lot of them, during live fire exercises, they use depleted uranium rounds. So guess what, genius? We got depleted uranium right here inside the U.S. And like I said to Doug, you know, one of the places that this has been done is up in the Florida Panhandle. The Air Force Base up there. he said, when I asked him, I said, so when a hurricane comes in and starts kicking up that dust and that dirt and the winds and stuff and throwing all those particles around, he said, the DU particles are getting picked up and blown around too. So how many civilians around military bases where they use DU during live fire drills, how many civilians have gotten hot particles in their lungs because of a dust storm or a hurricane or something else close by, depending on the location in the country that the base is at? And there's a few of them. Look what we did to Puerto Rico. Vieques. It's a little island off of Puerto Rico. The residents over in Vieques, full of cancer. Look it up. Look it up. One case, and I played this, I actually played this audio. You can go back and look at my archives. I covered this about 2.5 years ago. But I played audio. You can probably find the video on YouTube. Look up girls, young girls with cancer on Vieques or Vieques Island. And you'll see. This one girl, I think at the time she was 12 or 13 years old, and she had had two operations for cancer. She had had like half of her stomach removed because she had stomach cancer. She was 12 years old, and she was an island girl. Literally lived on this small island. Very simple life. Exposed to, well, what you would think, nothing exposed to like carcinogens, like big plants and stuff like that. No. It was all from the Navy bombing the hell out of the island using it as target practice. And between bombing it and then shooting it up with depleted uranium, people on that island are loaded with cancer. So I got sidetracked on this because Shinseki, the head of the VA, knows about all of this. Remember, he was Doug Rocky's boss in the 90s during the first Gulf War. He tasked him. He tasked him with cleaning up DU. Friendly calling for him to stand down because they've covered up the facts about depleted uranium. What about that? Go in my archives and look at my two interviews I've done with Doug Rocky. I'm going to have to try to get in touch with Doug again and see if he's okay, but I know he's been real sick lately. And I've interviewed him twice. They're in my archives. Dr. Doug Rocky on depleted uranium. Just go to federaljack.com and type in Doug Rocky, D-O-U-G space R-O-K-K-E, and hit enter. And the two interviews will come up. Shinseki was his boss when he was in the military, who tasked him with cleaning up the depleted uranium on the battlefield. They knew that it was killing people and causing cancer. And now he's the head of the Department of Veterans Affairs. And everybody's all pissed off over this kerfluffle with these guys dying. And I'll play the audio so you can hear what I'm talking about. But, and don't get me wrong, that's bad. But what about the DU? What about the millions of people that have been exposed to that stuff? Not just our own men and women. And by the way, the servicemen and women that were exposed to DU in the first Gulf War, if you listen to the interviews, Doug will tell you, you'll hear him say during the interview that most of our casualties were friendly fire casualties in the first war, which is the first Gulf War, which is true. And those all of those friendly fire casualties, most of them are now dead, if not all of them, because of cancer, because they were hit with depleted uranium rounds. So if they survived the trauma from the round hitting them, they were still exposed to the hot particles. And many of them within 5-10 years had died of various forms of cancers. So they survived being shot in deployment, but they were dead anyway from cancer. Shinseki, the head of the VA, knows this. They don't talk about it. It's this generation's Agent Orange. My dad's a Vietnam vet, and he's watched plenty of his Marine buddies die. My dad was an Airedale, so luckily he was flying around in helicopters and planes. And he wasn't exposed to it. He wasn't dumping it. But like my friend Ken Hildebrand, you guys have heard him on here once a couple times so far. He's a host I used to work with over at another network. Good friend of mine. Marine veteran, Vietnam. He was a door gunner. He was exposed to the Agent Orange. He has heart problems because of it. My father's friends have died of cancer and heart issues because of it. Are they going to talk about it? Are they going to admit that there's a problem with the DU? Is it going to take 50 years like it did with Agent Orange? And by the way, there was other things other than Agent Orange. Yellow, green, blue. They were called Agent whatever based on the barrel that they sat in because they were painted different colors depending on what it was. But they were all defoliants, and they were all chemicals, and they all caused neurological disorders, cancer, all sorts of crap. No joke. You think they're going to... I have a few other things I'd like to get into, hopefully, in the second hour. But I'm going to spend as much time on this as I need to take them to the woodshed. Now, I would have to do a week's worth of broadcast to actually woodshed the entire VA over all of their issues. Probably 2 weeks. Tonight is a few specific issues. And I'll throw out a few other things, but there's a few specific issues I'm going to focus on. Wait time for veterans seeking health care. Now, whenever I do a show about this stuff, there's always inevitably somebody in the comments, whether it's on Truth Frequency, Facebook, Twitter, Federal Jack, YouTube, wherever, that'll make a comment to the effect of, well, blah, 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 I don't feel bad for veterans, they shouldn't sign up to be oppressors, blah, 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 blah. If you can actually put that aside, because that's what enlightenment would call for, forgiving your fellow man for mistakes, and by the way, not all veterans are baby killers, okay, so you need to knock that crap off, and not everybody signs up to oppress people. There's a lot more to it. It's not just very black and white. It's a very gray area in a lot of aspects. Anyway, when I do these shows, I'm not doing these shows to try to ask you to pity and, oh, feel bad for veterans. I'm trying to show you that there's a huge problem. And if they're willing to do it to their own, they're willing to do it to the citizens. And it should also be a message to the active duty military and to the people that are police and government agents. Look how they treat their own. They don't even take care of you. When they're done with you, they throw you away. So there's a lot more to it than just, oh, please pay attention to veterans. That's a very superficial way to look at things. That's not using any semblance of logic. Besides, if the government's willing to do that to their own, what would they do to you, who they don't really care about at all? Think about that for a minute. Just think about that. You can judge a nation based off how it treats its military veterans. People it sent into harm's way, and in the case of the present day, they sign contracts. They own your ass when you're in the military. But in that contract, it also states that if you're hurt while you're active duty, they have to take care of you medically. That's part of the deal, okay? That's the way it works. It's not like people are getting free benefits and they're sitting on their butts doing nothing and they're partying. These are men with broken bodies.
Feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life. That there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. All I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people.
And now, welcome to another episode of Down the Rabbit Hole. Here's your host from FederalJack.com. It's Popeye.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another live edition. It is May 8th, 2014. Tonight's edition, I am going to the woodshed again. You're all going to go with me. If you're hanging out, listening, tuned in. Who goes to the woodshed tonight? The Department of Veterans Affairs goes to the woodshed tonight.